usually we have one stage of being novice. If you go to monastery or anywhere, the first time you get into that monastery, they keep you aside saying you are a novice, you are new, you can't learn anything. They will try to give you training mentally, physically, and after some time they will be called into next step of being initiated. That means now they have finished all their preliminary training, now they are ready to get into the center of the work. So like that, we also Christians, we have two parts like that, being novice and then trying to get initiated into the glory of Christ, into the love of Christ. Yes. So in that way we see Paul was always talking to the churches saying, you are only good for drinking milk, I cannot yet give you solid food. But that was one time when the church was in the beginning stage, we were giving milk. But then, now I think I can give you some solid food today. Amen. And also, Christianity is a very simple religion, but at the same time, it is a mystery religion. I'm not saying it is mysterious, but it is mystery religion. Mystery, when you say mystery, the Greeks, the Bible was, the New Testament was written in Greek, and the Greeks were always searching for wisdom. So that is why Paul, when he writes, he says, the Greeks search for wisdom and the Jews always search for signs. The Jews will always be for sign. That's why once they came to Jesus and said, give us a sign. And Jesus said, you foolish people, I won't give you any sign except the sign of Jonah. He was in the womb of the fish for 3 days, and so the Son of Man will be in the womb of the earth. Yes. I can give you only the sign, because Jews always search for sign, but Greeks, they always wanted wisdom. So Paul wanted to impress them about the Christian life, and he told them, don't think Christianity has no mystery like your religions have mystery. We have greater mystery than your mystery. So he wanted to write all the mystery. You know, he has written very mystery things. I'm not saying mysterious, it is mystery. Yes. And Jesus, once he called his disciples and said in Matthew 13, 11th verse, that you are called to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. So we are called not only to be novice, but to come more closer to God. As you come closer to God, you should know the mystery of God. So God said, there are many people around us. There are many people who just stand at the threshold and go away. They cannot take the mystery into their heart. But God has put his spirit and power in you so that you will know the mystery of God. And also in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, if you read the verse 3 and 4 and 5, you will find how Paul says, I want to tell you the mystery of God. You are called to know the mystery of God. So today, I think we have to talk, or at least we have to understand, I don't know whether I'll have time, but I will tell you very fast, the mystery that Paul talks about to the church. So of all, he talks seven mysteries that Jesus has revealed to Paul. You know, Paul, after he got converted, he had some problem, and half of the disciples did not believe Paul. They thought that he was giving trouble to all the Christians. He may give again trouble. So they didn't believe him full-heartedly. But one or two disciples believed him. So what they did is, when people came to catch Paul and kill him, the disciples put him in a basket and put him down. And from there they said, you run away from this place. You know where he went? He went to Arabia. And in Arabia he lived 3 years. At that time God revealed many things to Paul, and that's how Paul came to write all the epistles. So Paul got a special revelation from heaven to talk about the mystery of Christian life. So so many things, even communion table, Peter was doing it in a different way. During Peter's time, people all were having this communion. They didn't have the bread and wine as we have today. They all sat together, ate their stomach full, and they prayed, and they said that was the communion. So Paul in 1 Corinthians 11th chapter, he says, 10 chapters I think, he says, now don't you have your house to eat full? Go there and eat full. When you come here, you are coming to a very precious place where you will have the Holy Communion. Okay. He was the one who instituted the Holy Communion. Yes. He didn't follow the way of Peter, but he introduced a new one. So when he says that, he says, what I tell you now is not what comes from my heart. It is what the Lord showed me how to take this communion table. It was God who showed him many personal things. That is why after Christ, the Christian life was introduced, and so many things, so many rules and regulations were given through Paul. So Paul talks about the mystery. Now first mystery that I want to talk to you about is Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16. And there he talks about the gospel. The gospel is a mystery. The gospel is a great mystery. See, you and I are entrusted with this ministry. What a great inheritance this is. See, Christ has given us a great inheritance. To believe that Jesus had an incarnation, that the word of God became flesh and the flesh lived with us. The flesh became Jesus. So what a great mystery this is, because there are so many people in the world who cannot accept the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. They are not able to accept it. They say, how can it be? How can a God be born in the world? How can a God come from heaven and be put into the stomach of a virgin, and how can he be born? Now this is a great mystery that many people cannot understand. So they are able to, they are losing the heavenly kingdom just because of their unbelief. So here Paul says that they are blind, they are deaf, they are not able to understand the mystery of God. So the mystery of God is that he was born as a, he was born in the flesh. He had a virgin birth, the incarnation of God. Yes. So many are not able to believe in the incarnation of God. So Paul says that this is the mystery of God, that Jesus Christ was born in flesh and he died and he resurrected. How many people can believe the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Only you can believe, I can believe. Go and tell in the world that Jesus died on the third day he rose up. They are unable to believe. That is why they are not coming into Christianity. That is why they are not coming to the church. So what a privilege for us. Amen. To understand. Yes. Who gave you this wisdom? Amen. Who gave you this understanding? It is only the Holy Spirit that put that understanding in you. If the Holy Spirit had not touched you, if the Holy Spirit did not make your mind to believe it, you and I would not have believed it. Think, if we had been born a Muslim, if we had been born a Hindu, would we have accepted these things immediately? Don't know. But why did we accept? It is because Christ put the power in you to believe in the gospel, to believe in the reincarnation, to believe it. So that is the first mystery. The second mystery that you have to know, you just take it as things that God is revealing to you. Second one is Colossians chapter 2 verse 25 to 27. Can we read that? Colossians chapter 2 verse 25 to 27. Now here it is given, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen. Oh, sorry, 125. But is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Amen. So the second mystery is that Christ is living in you.
Amen.
Many people can't understand how Christ can live in you.
Amen.
Can you believe how Christ can live you? And that is the hope of our glory.
Amen.
So this mystery, it was hidden for generations. Old Testament people never say Christ is in my heart. Old Testament people never said that Christ is living in me, or God Jehovah is living in me. They never said. But for the New Testament people, it is revealed that Christ is living in you. So this that was kept as a mystery for generations, it is now revealed through Paul. And now we know that Christ is living in us. And that is the hope of glory. What is the advantage of Christ living in us? I tell all the sick people, when they become sick, by God's grace, I never get sick, because I always tell this prayer: Jesus, you are living in my body. My body is not an ordinary body. Because you are living in this body, how can a sickness enter? It does not dare to enter into my body. Sickness has to knock, and Jesus has to give the answer. You cannot enter into this body because I am here already dwelling in. So when Jesus is dwelling in your body, no sickness can enter. So this is what the privilege of people who have Christ in them. So what is the privilege? Peter went and asked Jesus, Jesus, we have left everything and we have come behind you. What is that you are going to give to us? So everybody's question is that, what is the privilege of having Jesus in us? So what is your privilege of having Jesus in you? If you have the Jesus, and you should know you have Jesus, that is the hope of your glory, that Jesus will not allow any sickness, any kind of thing to enter into your body.
Amen.
He is in your body, literal body, literal mind, literal heart. Jesus is living in us. So that is the second mystery that you have. Now, the third mystery that you can have is Ephesians chapter 3 verse 3. Can we read Ephesians chapter 3 verse 3? Yes, the mystery. Yes, the mystery of Christ. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which is given to me, how that by the revelation he made them known unto me the mystery, whereby when you read you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. The next fifth verse, can you read the fifth verse? Made known unto the sons of men, revealed that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Because of the gospel, we and the Jews, we have become one body.
Amen.
That is the greatest benefit of the gospel. Who are we? We were Gentiles. Only in the house of Cornelius, our redemption started.
Amen.
But Jews, they were called from Abraham's time. And the Jews have been a precious people unto God. And they were special people unto God. But how it came into the heart of God to combine the Gentiles and the Jews together.
Amen.
Are we not Gentiles? In what way we can share
yes.
the gospel?
Yes.
But God made the Gentiles
Amen.
And the Jews to
Glory.
Come as one.
Yes.
You know why? Because a day will come when Christ will be ruling this
Amen.
World. Very soon Christ literally, not spiritually, literally he will come to this world. I tell everywhere, now don't worry about this year. This year we'll wait and see what God is going to do. Definitely we are going to have a lot of changes this year. I tell my people, don't invest money in anything now. Wait and see, because after all the four times the blood moons have come, appeared, something is going to happen in this world. Now today I'm not talking about the coming of the Lord, but Jesus is going to come. He is going to come, and literally he is going to come into Israel, and there he is going to have his throne, and he is going to rule the entire world, sitting on the throne of David.
Yes.
The real throne where David sat, in the same throne where Solomon sat, in the same throne where all the kings of Israel sat, he is going to sit on that throne. On that day, he has earned Gentiles for him. Gentiles, we are the Gentiles. He is not only going to rule the Jews, he is also going to rule the Gentiles. Then can we have people now, how difficult it is, why we are having Tamil service, English service, Malayalam service? Because one can understand only one language, one can understand only one language. To have both of them together, it will not be so possible. In the same way, God is not going to rule Jews separately and Gentiles separately. He has to put everyone together. And that secret is happening now, that Gentiles and Jews are joined together now. So we are going to be like them and they are going to be like us. That is why most of the Jewish principles are now, so many people are going to Bethlehem, going to Jerusalem and bringing some of the things to the Gentiles. In many of the churches in America, the Gentile people are loving the Jews and following their principles. And now you see there is slowly a merging of Jews and Gentiles. Now if you watch many of the supernatural programs and all that, you will find that the Gentiles and the Jews are slowly mixing now, because it is a mystery. It is in the heart of God to make both people one. So we are going to become one. So many Jews are taking baptism. So many Jews are coming into the church. So many Jews are worshiping Jesus. So many things are happening. They are doing many things like Gentiles. And we Gentiles are doing many things like the Jews. This is a mystery here. It is talked about that Gentiles and Jews will share the common inheritance of the gospel.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The gospel is for everybody. For you and for the Gentiles, so that we will have one language, one church, one God, and one in everything. That is a great mystery. Now today we are not able to understand how this can be a mystery, but in Paul's days, Jews never mingled with anyone, and the Gentiles, they didn't even eat with the Gentiles. That's why Peter, when he came from Cornelius' house, Paul was very angry with Peter. You are pretending as if you don't know any of the Gentiles. You are sitting and eating with them, and today you are coming and talking against the Gentiles and all that. They had a problem. So because the Gentiles and the Jews never mixed.
Yes.
But today a time has come that the Gentiles and the Jews have mixed together, and that shows that Jesus is going to come very soon, and he is going to establish his kingdom on the earth.
Yes.
And we all are going to be the members, or we are going to be the citizens of Jesus' kingdom. So you are expecting a real kingdom now, not a spiritual kingdom. The kingdom is in this world. So that is the third one that you have understood, that we have common inheritance. Now the fourth one is, you have in Romans 11:25. Now it is a mystery. Now if you read chapter 11, Romans chapter 11 completely, you will have a great question. The question is, why did God reject the Jews? Why God had called the Gentiles and filling the places in heaven with the Gentiles? The Jews are not now given any kind of attention as the Gentiles were given attention. Everywhere the Gentiles are getting converted, they are coming into the church, great churches are formed, and God is present in the midst of the Gentiles, and the Jews are not given attention by God. So now Paul is telling, don't be proud thinking that God has called only you. You are a wild olive. They are the real olive. But you have to understand this mystery. God has rejected the Jews in order to give the gospel to the Gentiles.
Amen.
Remember, think, if we are not going to have the gospel, we will be gone to hell. But God in His mercy has given the gospel to the Gentiles. So what happens now? We Gentiles, we are given first preference now. So God will finish His work with the Gentiles. After finishing the work of redemption with the Gentiles, once again He will turn His attention to the Jews. Till then, Jews will have a stepmotherly treatment. Only Gentiles will have the primary love and treatment.
Amen.
That is what is in the heart of God. So that is what in Romans 11:25 we read. Romans 11:25, that the Jews will have a hard-heartedness for some time. Now everybody questions, why Jews are not believing their own brother Jesus? Why they are not believing their own brother Jesus? When they believe Jehovah, when they believe Jehovah and all the Ten Commandments, they are not believing in Jesus, Messiah. Why? So from the 60th AD, there is a hard-heartedness for Jews. This will continue until God fulfills the number of the Gentiles. He has the number. How many Gentiles must go to heaven? Are you not very happy that you are called to go to heaven? God has called you. He has given the Jews place. So your number is written there. So God says, until the number of the Gentiles is fulfilled, He will purposely keep the Jews unbelieving in Jesus. Then when the number is over, suddenly a redemption will come to the Jews and they all will repent in one day. That is what Zechariah says. One day they all will have repentance and they all will cry. The whole nation will cry and repent and they will accept Jesus.
Amen.
But why God is pushing them away? He wants to have Gentiles here because He loves the Gentiles.
Amen.
It is a mystery. For the Jews it is a mystery. For the disciples it is a mystery. Why God is not taking care of the Jews? Why Gentiles suddenly after Cornelius, Gentiles are coming to Jesus? So Paul says there again is a mystery, that God will keep the Gentiles' number. When it is fulfilled, then one day God will give redemption to the Jews. Till then, Jews will not be given a great redemption. So that is again, it shows God's love for the Gentiles. That is the fourth mystery that we should know about Christian life. Then the fifth one is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, from verse 6. Yes. Read, please.
And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way.
The mystery of iniquity. What is the mystery of iniquity? Antichrist is the mystery of iniquity. So, Antichrist is a mystery. This mystery is there, and we have to understand that this Antichrist will be revealed only after the Holy Spirit will be taken to heaven. Till Holy Spirit is here, Holy Spirit is preventing the Antichrist being known to the people. The spirit of iniquity. Who is the spirit of iniquity? Antichrist is the spirit of iniquity. But who is preventing him from being revealed to the people? Do you know who is Antichrist now? Do you know who is Antichrist? So many things are coming in the YouTube. Yes? Obama is here. Obama and so many. But do you really know who is the Antichrist? We do not know. Some people say he may come from Syria. ISIS leader may be the Antichrist. But yet we do not know who is preventing him. Holy Spirit is preventing. This is a mystery. This is a mystery that the Antichrist is not revealed, but one day the Antichrist will be revealed. Till then, Holy Spirit will be preventing him. So this Antichrist is a mystery. And we know that there is going to be an Antichrist. The world does not know there is going to be Antichrist. But we in the Bible, we know that Antichrist is there. And he is going to reign the world after the Holy Spirit is being taken away. One day the Holy Spirit will be taken away. Till then Antichrist cannot be revealed. People keep saying, keep guessing, this is the Antichrist, this is the Antichrist. But suddenly from heaven Jesus Christ will come. He will call his saints. You all will hear a voice saying, come unto me. All of you come. God will say, come. When he says come, all of you will fly. Do you know? You all will fly. You know to fly? But you will fly at that time because God will pull you unto him with his power. All of us will fly. Do you know what song you will sing at that time? Yes? You will sing a song. What is the song? Death, where is your sting? Death, where is your sting? Because you couldn't make us die. Where is your sting? We are flying. All of us will fly. When we are flying into heaven, Holy Spirit will bring us to yes. God. Holy Spirit will be the Eliezer. You know the story of Abraham and Isaac. Eliezer was the one who brought Rebekah. You are indirectly, you are Rebekah, you are the bride, and Holy Spirit will go and present us to God the Father. So that is going to be a mystery that we should know now. Then the next one is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51.
Behold, I show you a mystery.
Behold, I'll show you a mystery. Again, one more mystery. What is the mystery?
We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed.
We shall not all be, we will not die, but will be transformed. That's a great mystery. Can you imagine how you will be transformed? Is it not a mystery that you will be transformed? You will not die, but suddenly you will be given a different body and you will be ready to fly.
Amen.
So how can we understand that? Is it not a mystery? It is a mystery. But Paul says there is one mystery, that we will not all die, but we will be transformed, and then in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. How many of us can believe this? Okay, those who are in the church can believe. How many people outside, the great philosophers, the great people who have learned philosophy, this and that, doctors, how many of them can believe this? They cannot believe. They will say, how can a dead body rise up after 200 years, after 300 years? After 300 years, will the dead body rise? Can you imagine? Suppose that's the day you all go, November 2nd, All Saints Day. You go to the graveyard. You are putting flowers and all that on the grave. But that day God comes and the grave opens. What will you do? You'll be afraid. Even though you know it will happen, still when the grave opens, we all will tumble and fall, and so many accidents will happen there. So even on a saint's day, if God comes, we are unable to believe it. How a dead body can rise up with the body given to them by God. This is a mystery. So Paul says, this again is the mystery in Christian life, that one day all the dead bodies will rise, and all of us who are alive, we will have a different body, and we all will fly together to go and meet Jesus. So this is a real mystery that we are going to have, and this will definitely happen. This will definitely come to pass. It may come today or tomorrow or day after tomorrow or next year, but anyhow, I know that it is going to happen very soon. So be ready for this. This is what we call rapture. Pastor often talks about rapture. Suddenly you are raptured, maybe raptured, maybe raptured. What is it? Suddenly you will be gone. Nobody will know. Suppose you are You are working in a working place. Everybody is not a Christian. You are a Christian. You are driving a great vehicle, or you are driving, you are pilot of an aeroplane. You will be taken and the aeroplane will go and fall somewhere. So when my father, first time he went to America, he brought a t-shirt. And it is written there, in case of rapture, this t-shirt will be empty. Which means that the man who is wearing the t-shirt will go. The t-shirt will fall. All your clothes will fall. Everything will be there. But the man missing. So in America in 70s, there was a great revival. So what they did, they had two pilots for every airplane. And that's how they started having the two pilots. One is a believer and the other one is a non-believer. In case the believer is taken, the non-believer will pilot the plane. They had a great faith in those days. So my father used to say, when you are getting into a bus, into a car, a Christian is driving, be sure either you give your heart to Jesus, otherwise don't get into it. Christ will come at any time and that will go into accident. So husband and wife will be lying in the same bed, and I suppose it's early morning, the husband will be sleeping, the wife is always praying, coming to IPS shelter house. The husband never came, in spite of repeated calling, he never came. So one morning Christ came, Jesus came, and the wife went away. The husband is lying down. Oh, why coffee did not come? Why coffee did not? He'll be scolding the wife. She's always like that. Late. What lazy bug she is. He gets up and searches everywhere. No wife is found. Her clothes are there. Her ornaments are there. Everything is there. If the milkman is a very good man, milkman did not come that day. No milk. Waiting, no milk, because the milkman is gone. That's what God says. Two people will be in the bed. One will be missing. Two people will be grinding flour. One will be missing. Two people will be working in the field. One will be missing. And this is what is going to happen when Christ is going to come. So that is why we have to be ready. If it is on a Sunday morning, a church like this will be empty. All your relatives will be saying, oh, the papers will give news. That day there will be a great demand for papers and TV and all that. And your relatives will say, that's why I told them, don't go to that church. You will not be good in that church. Repeatedly we told him not to go to that church. Now see, my son is not there, or my daughter is not there, or my relatives are not there. Because it came on a Sunday morning, and Sunday morning all of us, as we were singing the wondrous story, song, we all went away. Amen. So such things will happen. Wait and see. This will happen again. Papers will talk about this. People will have a hard heart towards it, because they will think that something happened to some people. It's not going to bother. They are going to live another 7 years under the Antichrist. This is going to happen. But it is a great mystery that God has revealed you. And it is a great power of God that He has saved you. It's a great power of the gospel that it has brought you to His fold. And you are able to know this mystery, that one day this thing will happen. And the last one is Ephesians chapter 5 verse 32. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 32. Yeah.
This is the great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church.
Christ and the church. Yes, it's a great mystery. The Christ loves the church as His wife. Now, Paul says, many people say that Paul is not married, he doesn't know anything and all that. What? Whatever it be, that is why he says don't get married again and all that in chapter about the marriage. Many people say that Paul had a bad smell coming in his body. That's why he told Galatians, you know, even if you never hated the bad smell that's coming from my body. And his eyes also became blind because of the vision he had from God. So he said to Galatians, you were willing to give even your eyes. So because of his because of some complexity, he never had girlfriends, or he never was very free with the girls, and that's why he always condemns ladies. That's what some people complain about Paul. But whatever whoever it be, Paul, he understood one thing very well, the love of the husband for the wife. So he says, this is a great mystery God taught him, that the church is loved by our bridegroom Jesus. Amen. The love of God with the church is something very great, very mystery. It's a great mystery. We can't understand that. It's a greater love. So God loves the church very much. That is why when you, even if we commit mistakes and all that, God always calls us, my beloved, my beloved bride. He always calls the church as a beloved. He loves the church very much because it is his wife, it is his bride, and bridegroom loves his bride, God loves us. Amen. It was he who gave birth to us, and it was he who gave birth to the church, and he loves the church very much. And one day, the bridegroom is waiting now. He is asking all the time, God the Father, when can I go and see the bride? When can I go and see the bride? It is always the desire of the man to go and see his bride. Yes, he is the one. Yeah, we are now at the, that's correct, we are now at the engagement time. It is, we are engaged and we are waiting for the marriage. We are waiting for the marriage. The time now we are spending on earth is the engagement time. Amen. So one day the bridegroom, yes, will come and he will show his love for the bride. Amen. We are the bride. It is a very great mystery. Now read Revelation chapter 21 verse 9 and 10. Revelation chapter 21 verse 9 and 10.
And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will shew thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and shewed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God.
Amen. See, now here, even in that day, angel took John and showed the bride. You know what he showed the bride? Jerusalem, the great building. Inside the building, he showed your face and my face. Amen. All our faces were shown. That's why the angel came and said, I will show you the bride. Bride means not one person. It is the church. The bride is the church. So when you are inside the church, you are the bride. When you are outside the church, you are not the bride. We can't be the bride. So your place in the church is very, very important, because it is the place of the bride. So what is the love of Christ for the bride? Now tell me, which husband will allow his wife to suffer? If he is a real good man, he will never allow his wife to suffer. He will help the wife. He will do everything. That is why Christ also loves the bride. Amen. And that is why we have all confidence that if we go and pray to Jesus, he will remove our sufferings. He will remove our sorrows. Yes. He will give us life. He will give us whatever we ask. See, whatever you ask, the wife goes and asks the man, or before engagement more so. I mean before the marriage more so. That is why people, you are very much afraid. No, before the marriage, whatever the bride asks, the bridegroom will readily give. After the marriage, he will be very careful about his pocket. But before marriage, he wants to show to his bride that he is a very generous person. So even if he is really a stingy person, before marriage he won't show that. He will spend money, whatever she asks, he will give. Now we are in the engagement time. Amen. Whatever you ask, God will give you. We have a good bridegroom. God says, the evil people in the world, I am greater than the evil people in the world. You are an evil parent, you will not, even though you are an evil parent, you will not give a scorpion for egg, or you will not give snake for fish and all that. So stone for, if you, the evil people, know how to do good to your children, how much more I will do. Amen. The same thing God says, you are my bride. You are my bride. I have put you into this mystery. I have revealed my mystery to you. You are my bride. How much more I will do more than the earthly husbands, more than the earthly bridegrooms. I am a heavenly bridegroom. You are my bride. How much I love you. How much I will help you. How much I will be removing all your sorrows. Because Christ wants his bride to be happy in this world. Christ wants his bride to have everything in this world. Because he is the one owner of the entire world. He is the owner of the entire world. He is the creator. He made everything. How can he make us suffer in this world when he is our bridegroom? No true bridegroom will make his wife suffer or bride suffer. In the same way, in the morning, Christ tells you, you are my bride. You are my beloved. You are my precious. How can I make you suffer? So whatever you ask, he will be willingly giving you, generously giving you. He will be helping you. He will take care of you. He will lead you, guide you, until both are united in the heavenly kingdom. So his protection, his love, his care, everything is upon you. What do we fear now? What do we have fear? Do we have fear now? When you are inside the church, he has covered you with his mantle of love. So are you under the mantle of Christ? Are you under the mantle of Christ as a bride? Are you under his custody? If you are under the bridegroom's mantle, you need not worry about anything. The success is yours. The world is yours. The joy of the world is yours. The joy of the heavenly kingdom also is yours. Amen. He will take care of you. He will make you walk with him. Yes. He will give you green pastures. He will give you still waters. He will give you all the blessings of this world and the next world, as he said to Peter. So let us stand up and worship him and tell him, Lord, I am happy I am your bride. I am happy I am your bride.